Ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be one of the first welcomers to the event tonight. I want to say just a couple of sentences, if you will, on behalf of the Latino Coalition, a community grassroots organization. We're very pleased to co-host this candidates forum this evening in coordination with the League of Women Voters. We've done this before, and I'll say it again, there is no more respected powerhouse of an organization than the League of Women Voters. They do this for a living, and they do it so well. So we're very proud to be part of their effort. The Latino Coalition believes that an informed citizen is the best guarantor of our democratic process. It is therefore important for this forum to be held because it does inform the citizen, and it does allow the citizen to ask questions of the candidates that are of particular interest to the citizen. So, part of a larger process, we also do voter registration drives throughout the year, again, in coordination with the League. So with that, let me just say that it is my exceptional pleasure to introduce the moderator for this evening's candidates forum from the League of Women Voters, Ms. Kay Autumn. Kay?
Thank you all for being here. I'm sad that there's not more people here, but I need to remember this is being recorded to be shown on local TV and on YouTube, so we'll take heart in that. So, I want to start with a few thank yous, thanking the Pasco Police Department for letting us use this facility. I want to thank John Funfar and his crew for taping the forum. And I want to make clear that the League of Women Voters as an organization and the Latino Coalition of Tri-Cities as a coalition, we do not support or oppose any candidates. As Felix said, we want the voters to become better informed about the people who are running for public office. So tonight, overall, we're going to be hearing from candidates seeking the position of state representative from the 9th District, the 16th District, and for Franklin County Commissioners. We'll be using the following format. Each candidate will make a 2-minute opening statement. We'll then move to a question and answer period with a 1.5-minute limit on responses. And I don't see a timekeeper out here. we ask that if she'll hold up like a 15-second, and we just ask that you wrap up at that point. Don't stop mid-sentence, but wrap up your thoughts at that point. All candidates running for the same position will answer the same questions. We'll alternate who goes first. We have prepared questions, but we're also taking questions from the audience. If anyone cares to write a question on a 3x5 card, and Marilyn, I don't know, you're the one here really working, and maybe someone will collect them if you hold it up, and that should go fine.
There are cards on the back table.
There are cards on the back table.
And then we'll collect one.
Okay. Okay, and candidates, I'll point out the timer. So she is there now. So let's begin. I would like to introduce the candidates running for state representative, position 1 from the 9th District. They are Mary Dye and Jennifer Goulet. For simplicity's sake, we're going to be using sort of alphabetical order. So we'll begin with an opening statement from Mrs. Dye.
Thank you so much, Kay, and also Felix, for hosting this event. I so appreciate the opportunity to be here. I married my farmer 29 years ago, and we farm 3,000 acres in Pomeroy, Washington. And I've raised 3 girls on that farm, numerous horses, and countless pets. As a mother of 3 girls, one at college in Washington, D.C., and another who has had learning disabilities that have left her seriously behind her peers. My heart is linked to the understanding that in Olympia, we must open our eyes to the root needs of each and every family so that we can create communities that can be successful now and in the future. My sense is that the people in Pasco and in this community, you are very hardworking. You care about education, your family, your faith, jobs, and having opportunities for higher education. I was at the ground floor for the restoration of charter schools in our state. My vision is that we must provide options for learning that is secure and joyful for all the children, every child, and provide a choice for every family. The 9th District representatives spearheaded the 15% reduction in tuition in the state-run universities. And that tuition cut was unprecedented. No other state in the union has ever had the courage to cut tuition. And that was led by lawmakers in your district. I am also working on legislation that will create infrastructure that will change the economic dynamic for our region, one that is utterly unique to our state. I am a small business owner, I'm a soil scientist, I'm a farmer, and as your state representative, I would appreciate your support. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Galay, your opening statement.
Well, hello, everyone. I am Jennifer Goulet, and I'm the first vice chair of the Franklin County Democrats and a member of the board of directors for Planned Parenthood of Greater Washington and North Idaho. And I also co-founded and am the current president of Tri-City Freethinkers, which is a nonprofit organization based here in the Tri-Cities. My day job is I work at the Hammer Federal Training Center in Richland, developing training for the Department of Energy nationwide. So why do I want to be your representative? My top priorities would include funding education and other vital services. And the way to do that, I believe, is to ensure that large corporations are paying their fair share of taxes. In order to do that, we need to develop a system for measuring the value that they add for Washington's economy. And I don't believe that the bulk of the burden of funding our society should fall on small business owners and average taxpayers like yourselves. I also believe in a living wage. I want to see it tied to the cost of living in an area, so 15 may be great in some areas and not so great in others. And I also would love to see higher education and career training be more affordable or even free, long-term goal. Implementing a public option for healthcare in Washington State would be another thing I'd love to see happen. I want to address the severe shortage of mental health care services, especially in Eastern Washington. And I want to work on meeting our energy needs through a mix of solar, wind, hydro, and nuclear. I believe we have a moral obligation to take care of each other and that it makes economic sense to do so. And together, I believe that we can build a society that works for all of us. I ask for your support and your vote November 8th.
Thank you. Okay, we'll move on to question and answers. I think that rather than having the two candidates answer, having to answer back to back by alternating, we're going to start, and I'm planning on 6 questions for sure. We'll have Mrs. Dye answer the first 3 first, and then we'll have Ms. Goulet answer the second 3 questions first. And that should come out even. So, the first question, and we'll start with you. The federal government and some other states have been pursuing raising the federal minimum wage to $15 an hour. The current minimum wage in the state of Washington is $9.47 an hour. Initiative 1433, which is on the November ballot, is a measure that would increase the state hourly minimum wage for employees who are at least 18, beginning with an increase to $11.50 in 2018, $12 in 2019, and $13.50 in 2020. It would also require starting in 2018 employers to provide paid sick leave that employees could use in certain circumstances, including to care for family members. If you are in support of increasing the state minimum wage, would you agree with the components of this initiative, or do you have an alternative plan to accomplish this? If you do not support increasing the state minimum wage, why not?
Okay, I'm not in favor of increasing the minimum wage because it's like pushing a rope or the dog chasing its tail in a lot of ways. The way the economy works in the free market is that the employee contributes value to the enterprise, and that value is then fed into that system, and the value that is created is compensated appropriately. And so you end up with increasing minimum wage in an arbitrary way through a government mandate, and what happens is that it just increases the cost of goods and services across the economy, and nobody gains. So, you know, when you look at an employment sector that has both government and private enterprise, that mandate falls doubly on the private sector. What you need to look at is how do we release the burden of regulation on private enterprise so that the people that work there can increase the value contribution to the enterprise and have ownership in that increase of value. And that's how I see economic growth works, from allowing companies to be successful, prosperous, and let that feed into the employment. That's how I look at it.
Thank you. Ms. Goulet?
Oh, I thought I was doing three in a row.
Oh, well, no. You're each going to answer, but she gets to go first, the first three questions, gotcha. And then you get to go first.
All right. So I think that this myth that when wages go up, that jobs get lost or hours get cut. It's at best a myth. At worst, it's a lie. It's what they want you to think. What we know from research is that when the economy is already doing well or picking up, that when wages go up, jobs increase. And when the economy is not doing so well and we're heading into a recession, and it doesn't matter what we do then at that point for wages. So it really has to do with the fluctuations of what's happening in the economy at any given time. It makes sense, and I know this from personal experience from having operated a small business with my father, that when people have money to spend, they're going to spend it. So if people are barely able to make rent and still have money for food and gas at the end, they're probably not going to go out and buy your, you know, whatever widget it is that you're selling if it's not essential to their life. But if they have extra money to spend, then they're going to buy it, and then you have more business, and then you can hire more employees. And that is the virtuous cycle that happens when people have money to spend. It's very simple. And as far as the sick leave, I think that's another thing that just makes sense. Nobody should be going to work sick. It's bad for the individual, it's bad for their coworkers, it's bad for the customers, and overall it's bad for the business. So people should be able to take time off when they need to.
Thank you. Okay. Second question, and we'll start again with you. Due in large part to a lack of treatment options, many people with mental health problems end up in the prison system. Do you think that more state resources should be directed to this problem?
Yes, I think mental illness is going to be a major funding crisis for the state government, because we see that our method of treating mental illness is one of it doesn't look at mental illness as a disease. It looks at it as a behavior. And so we continually run through the revolving door of prison and then out on the street, breaking down prison. And so I would like to see us treat mental illness as a physical illness like heart disease or any other organ disease, and drive resources to the study of brain diseases, drive resources into the hospitals that can treat brain diseases. I think mental illness and brain disease is a significant issue that has been left largely caught up in a culture that wants to still stigmatize it. The behaviors that result from mental illness are predictable because of the dysfunction of the organ of the brain, and we need to research it, we need to find better ways to treat it, and we need to treat it like any other illness. We have heart disease that is excessive in our society, and brain disease links very tightly in the same category, and we need to treat it.
Thank you. Ms. Galay?
Well, I agree with all of that. Mental health care is definitely something that the state should be stepping in on, because it's really it's damaging our entire society. For one, it's unfairly burdening our police officers, who should not be, it should not fall on them to deal with people with mental health or drug abuse issues. They don't belong in jail. They belong in treatment. We need more doctors. We need, there's apparently, according to a doctor that I know, she was telling me that there's a nationwide shortage of mental health care professionals in general. So it's not just an issue of, you know, why can't we pay more to get them to move here? There's a shortage. And so obviously on the Washington state level, that's kind of out of my control to do anything on the national level, but I would like to see us find a way to increase students' interest at the medical schools in Washington State, maybe even offer some sort of an incentive for them to go into that field, and get the treatment or the treatment facilities and the healthcare professionals that we need to be able to deal with it, because it's a really bad problem. It's affected me personally. I have a daughter with high functioning autism and another who struggles with some pretty bad depression, and it shouldn't take 9 months to a year to get a doctor, but I can tell you what, it does.
Thank you. Okay, for our third question, Mrs. Dye. Both farms and cities rely on groundwater and wells for irrigation and municipal needs, and much of this water is drying up or predicted to within the next 20 years. What role can and should the state take to address this important issue for our area?
This is a real pertinent issue right now, right today, because yes, our wells, our potable water in the Odessa subaquifer has gone dry, and the Lind has brought up white foam instead of water in their well earlier this year. And it has really motivated policymakers to understand that we have to get the deep well irrigators off of those wells and onto surface water and finish the promise that was made to our region that the Bureau of Reclamation would put pumps on the siphons and the canals that we have installed and use surface water for irrigation so that we can preserve the potable waters in the aquifers for the cities and towns that live here. And so I think we finally have the political will. I never thought I would see it in my lifetime, but it's time now that we get the irrigators off the aquifers and really deal with the issue of water and make sure that we have water available for the towns and cities that depend upon the potable water that's in the aquifers. I'm very excited about Othello going ahead and pumping water and repatriating some of the Odessa subaquifer. I think there's so much technology that can be deployed in this area. I think that water is finally going to be a resource that we can really deal with politically in this state right now, and I'm very happy about it.
Thank you. Ms. Galay?
This is actually a new thing to me, that we have wells drying up. That definitely doesn't sound good. So I would want to know, what is the reason that that the state hadn't been dealing with it? Did they have a lack of funds? And find out what those causes are. But certainly it's something that does have to be addressed, and I would look into that if elected.
Okay, thank you. I did have one question here from the audience that I forgot about that I'm going to throw in here. Doesn't really matter who answers it first, because it's just a kind of a question of interest. And before we switch for you to go first, I'm going to ask you both, and you can go ahead. Excluding the Bible, what is the most recent book you have read, or how do you spend your time? What do you read? If not a book, what do you read most often?
The most recent book I've read is a book by Russell Kirk, which was written in 1953, called The Conservative Mind, where he outlines the history of political thought from Burke to T.S. Eliot. I have devoured that book because of its fascinating history, the body of thought, the nuances, the differences between Montesquieu and Rousseau fascinate me. I think it informs me in ways that I never thought I would understand. The language is rich with poetry, and I've just enjoyed it so much. And it motivates me very much to study further into the history of Western civilization and why, you know, Plato, Aristotle, Cicero, all of these things that my kids have had the opportunity to learn, I want to play catch up with them. And that has been a fascinating read, and I encourage anybody to read it.
Thank you. Ms. Goulet?
I am constantly reading, by which I mean I'm constantly on the road and I'm listening to Audible everywhere I go or downloading ebooks from the library. So I'm sitting here trying to think, well, because right now I'm listening to a science fiction book called Snow Crash, because I've been doing a lot of nonfiction and I decided it was time for a break. And it's a weird one. But most recently, I think the last nonfiction that I finished was either The Republican Brain, really good one, and then White Trash, The Untold History of 400 Years of Class in America. Outstanding book, highly recommend it. I don't know what I'm going to read next, so I'm taking suggestions.
Okay, thank you. All right, we'll get back to our little bit more serious questions. And Ms. Goulet, I'll start with you. Do you think charter schools are an alternative choice to our public K-12 system that should be expanded and funded by public tax dollars?
Oh, charter schools funded by public tax dollars. So then essentially, well, okay, I see what you're saying. I want to see our education improved and have a lot of diverse options for different kind of students. But what I do want to make sure we keep is control, that school boards are overseeing them. I don't want to see for-profit charter schools in our state, and thankfully right now we don't have that. And I know that something is going on that we've just received a federal grant for charter schools in Washington State, so I'm not quite sure yet what that means for charter schools here. But I don't see any reason why we can't have the types of innovative things that that charter schools are doing done in public school settings. We have some examples here in the Tri-Cities. There's Phoenix in Kennewick. They're doing some pretty neat things over there, and Delta in Pasco is also doing some pretty amazing things, and those are public schools. So I just don't understand why it has to be a charter system that isn't that doesn't have the oversight that a public school does. And as long as it's not taking any resources away where certain communities, lower income communities, or students in special education classes, as long as they're not negatively impacted, then I'm fine with trying new and different things with school.
Thank you. Mrs. Dye?
Having raised three girls that are all three very different from each other, I know that one size does not fit all. And charter schools was an idea that was spawned to give opportunities for families who would have no other option, and kids that maybe didn't fit in the public school box. And it gives them a choice to do something that works for their own kid and their own family. So it was a great honor to be a part of the team that was able to get charter schools reinstated in the state of Washington. That night was probably one of the best nights in the session that we had most recently, seeing how we were able to come together in non-traditional coalitions of support to offer options for families who would otherwise be stuck with one choice and one choice alone. So to me, I would love to see us really evaluate What is the magic key that makes charter schools different, and can we institute some of those things into the public school debate? Maybe it is more local control of the charter school. Maybe it's less regulation. Whatever it is, I would like to see the success of the charter schools be part of the conversation to help all public schools be more successful.
Thank you. I have a question here from the audience that I need some clarification on. It says, Initiative 873 is aiming to take out the malice and with good faith thresholds in our justifiable homicide statute. Do you support this initiative? Is that on the ballot? Right. It's not on the ballot, but I'll go ahead and ask you first if whether it be legislation comes up about it or it is initiative. Do you support that takes out the malice and with good faith thresholds in our justifiable homicide statute?
I do. Washington State is the only state in the country that has the bar set so high that it's almost impossible to convict an officer when there really is, malice or when they really should have been convicted. Because of that language, it just makes it almost impossible. So I think that by striking the word or two words that the initiative is looking to have removed, it puts us pretty much, as it is in other states where it's already pretty darn hard, and to hold officers accountable when they really truly do something wrong.
Thank you. Mrs. Dye.
You know, my biggest issue is with the initiative process itself. You know, it's the law of unintended consequence of direct democracy versus using representative government and the legislative body. What happens in the legislature is that you have a whole number of processes that knock the rough edges off of a political idea or a policy idea. And through committees and negotiations and shopping the idea with stakeholders, you end up having a piece of legislation that avoids a lot of the mistakes and unintended consequences. For example, if the voters had known that the classroom size initiative was going to cost the state $9 billion, they might have rethought their choice on that, or maybe have narrowed it down. That in a legislative body would have been narrowed down and had some sideboards on it to keep it from overriding the entire state budget. So these are the types of things that legislators are elected to do, is to try and work together, bipartisan, cooperative with numerous stakeholders across the state and your district, representing the interests of your district, to make good law, good policy, good public policy. So when you have an initiative that deals with something as important as the relationship between police and communities, I should think that it should be vetted through the legislature.
Okay, thank you. The last question here I want to ask, and you'll go first, is about another initiative, Initiative 735, which is on the ballot. It supports a federal constitutional amendment that limits constitutional rights to people, not corporations. In other words, do you believe corporations are people?
No.
Why or why not?
Citizens United is, I think, one of the worst affronts to democracy that the United States has ever witnessed. And we definitely need to do whatever it takes to move past that, and I don't see Congress doing anything about it anytime soon. So this initiative, and I understand what Mary Dye is saying about the initiative thing, yes, they can have unintended consequences. But right now, with all of the power of government being controlled by the super wealthy and the mega corporations, we need initiatives, because that is the only way that the people still have a say anymore, because they can't count on their legislators to listen to them when they're listening to the guy who's funding their campaign. or woman. So, yes, I support this particular way of going about getting money out of politics and saying that, that corporations are not people. Because I know that there's a couple of different ways that they're trying to go about it, and one would, I think, open up a huge can of worms, which is the constitutional, I'm drawing a blank on it right now, but where basically all of the states get together and can rewrite the whole Constitution. I think that's a bad idea. But this one I support.
Okay, thank you. Mrs. Dye.
You know, this is one thing that hits me right in the heart. Let me tell you about some of the people I know that run corporations and invented things. Two that come to mind is Ari Hansen and Ed Schweitzer, and my father-in-law for that matter. They all started with an essay in college and came up with an idea and pursued it with passion and then grew to be big. None of them started with much, but all of them ended with a big idea, and that's the pursuit of the American dream. Each one of those people would say that as they grew through the process and incorporated, and then in the case of Ed Schweitzer, converted it to employee-owned, and then ended up giving back to the community in ways that we can call countless. I would have to say that it's an affront to the people, the great Americans, whether it's Bill Gates or whether it's Matt Hansen or whether it's whoever it is. Each one of these great corporations represent the dream of real hardworking people that created that wealth. And that is the American dream. And they should have a say in the political system every bit as much as any other citizen. And that's how I feel.
Thank you. Okay, we will now move to closing statements, and we'll reverse the order from the opening statements. So Ms. Galay, would you please go first?
Sure. I can't disagree more. I kind of just want to respond to that thing about corporations. that it's great that they've made these wonderful businesses, but to use their vast amount of wealth to rig the system in their favor, to make sure that they're paying as few taxes as possible, that is not what's good for you and me, and that is not what's good for small business owners either, because somebody's going to be picking up the bill to make sure that our state services are funded, like education. And if it's not Microsoft and it's not Amazon, it's you, small business owners, and it's you and your parents and your neighbors, and that is not acceptable to me. That is not America. Nobody else can live the American dream if it's concentrated by just a tiny fraction of 1% of people who live the dream. And so if you believe that too, then please check me out, jen4wa.com, and please vote on November 8th. Thank you.
Thank you. Mrs. Dye?
It's been an honor and privilege to be with you tonight. And you know, it all starts with the dream of providing a world-class education to every kid in our community. And what is that world-class education for? But to invest in those kids so that they can pursue with abandon the talents and gifts and abilities that they've been given, and to have the tools that they need to find that unique thing that they were made to do right now in this place. That's what we're about as a country, as a state, and as a community, is to provide those supports, those inspirations, so that the next generation of people that live here in Pasco can do more with the time and the energy that they have, so that their lives are meaningful and purposeful and leave an impact for our community for the generations to come. And I would appreciate your support to do that. Thank you.
Thank you. And let's all thank these two candidates for taking the time to be with us tonight. Okay, we'll take a short break while the candidates running for both positions in the 16th district come on up. Okay, I'd like to welcome the candidates running for state representative from the 16th District. For position one, we have Rebecca Francik and Bill Jenkin. And for position two, we have Gary Downing and Terry Neely. Let me quickly review the format for you. 2-minute opening statements, 1.5 minute responses to questions, and 1 minute closing. I'm going to ask some of the questions of all four of you and others just to one position or the other and hope I can keep what I'm doing straight. But we will begin with opening statements, sort of in alphabetical order. So for position one, Mrs. Francik, your opening statement, please.
Thank you, good evening. My name is Rebecca Francik, and I am running for the Washington State House position number one, 16th Legislative District. I have lived and worked in Pasco for over 30 years. My husband and I have raised 7 great kids here, and now I teach your children in the Pasco school system. If you vote Francik, I can offer you 19 years of fiscally responsible local government experience, over 18 years of direct working experience in the K-12 education system, and a solid grounding in agriculture, which is the number one driver of Washington's economy. Agriculture is extremely important to the 16th District. With a Bachelor of Science in Agronomy and real field experience, I have a comprehensive understanding of the issues impacting this industry. I understand their water needs, their transportation needs, and their environmental issues. With 2 master's degrees, I currently work as a nationally board certified teacher for Pasco Schools. I know firsthand the issues facing educators, students, and taxpayers as we work together to provide an education that prepares our students to be fully competitive in filling jobs created by Washington industries. Lastly, I have served as a Pasco City Council member for 19 years. I have a long history of collaborating with other public agencies to improve industrial opportunities in Walla Walla, Benton, and Franklin counties. Appointed by 2 governors, I have represented our region on the Washington State Public Works Trust Fund Board and the Freight Mobility Strategic Investment Board. I have helped prioritize, fund, and build roads, bridges, sewer, and water systems throughout our state. Most recently, I've worked with the Pasco City Council and the ACLU to change Pasco's voting districts and processes to ensure that our Latino citizens have an equal opportunity for representation in Pasco. If you believe this experience will benefit you, I am asking you to vote Francik. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Jenkin.
Yes. I'd like to thank the League of Women Voters, the Latino Coalition, and all of you for being here tonight. First, a little bit about myself. I hold a BA in business management, and I've been able to put it to good use. I'm currently the president of the Prosser School Board. I'm a financial advisor. I own Prosser Vineyards and Winery and 2 tasting rooms, as well as commercial property in downtown Prosser. In addition to my elected positions and businesses, I have been very involved in my community. I'm the district governor-elect for Rotary District 5060. I was the founding chairman for the Boys and Girls Club in Prosser. I served the Prosser Chamber of Commerce for 2 years as its president. I'm also a board member for the People for People. The reason I'm a candidate for this position is that I and others believe that experience matters. I live the issues facing our communities every day. Our economy has been struggling for almost a decade. And as a small business owner myself, I can say with authority that we need to do more to support our job creators in all of our communities. We need to reduce the B&O tax, which strangles the working capital of our small businesses, greatly reducing our chances of success. Our state needs to address our educational challenges without raising taxes. We need to work towards local control of our schools. We need to restore parental and student choice in our students' education. Not all of our students want or need to go to a liberal arts college. Many students would thrive in the trades. Finally, we need to encourage, this is the most important, we need to encourage our parents to take a much greater responsibility in their children's education. We should do more to support our local farmers It is essential that we secure and strengthen our farmers' water rights now and into the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Downing.
Thank you. My name is Gary Downing, and I'd like to thank the League of Latino Coalition, the League of Women Voters. I'd like to thank the Pasco City Television, KNDU, and Richland City View, and the Pasco Police Department for allowing us to use this facility. I am running for the 16th Legislative District, seat number 2. You know, I was raised in the Tri-Cities. I actually graduated out of Pasco High in 1965, after which I went into the service. And then when I got out of the service as an Airman First Class, I decided that since I hadn't really traveled in the service, I was going to travel around the United States. I was given the opportunity to travel through all the states, work in places like Alabama, Mississippi, Florida, Kentucky, and places of that nature. And I actually found out what poverty was, something I never want to see in this state. I retired started working for Richland School District in 1985. And I retired from there in 2015 after 30 years of service. During which time I was working full time, I also became the president of the Art Association of CBC twice. I was elected president of the Woodman Lodge. And that's where I actually had the chance to purchase flagpoles and get them mounted, actually do the excavation, pour the concrete, and set them up around the Tri-Cities and Benton City, actually. And they have a plaque at the bottom that in remembrance of those who passed away in the 9/11 events. I'm a veteran, a member of the American Legion, a member of the Moose, and a member of the Eagles. And if you go into the Pasco Eagles, you will see a painting on one wall that myself and one other person painted there. I have always been in public service, and I've always worked on people's issues and problems with positive results. And I'm not done. My name is Gary Downing, and I'm running for the 16th Legislative District for the number 2 seat. And I do hope that I will have your support and your vote. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mr. Neely, your opening statement.
Well, thank you, and also thank you to the sponsors for providing this forum. It's important for the public to be involved and to hear our positions. I'm Terry Neely, and I'm running for the state representative position number 2. I've held this office now for seven years, and it's been a real experience, a great experience. Just a quick background by me. I was raised on a farm in Whitman County. I learned what hard work was at a very young age, and I've still had trouble shaking that habit. I graduated from WSU in finance. Went through ROTC, so I served in the Army for 2 years, after which I attended Gonzaga Law School and graduated in 1974. I then went to work as a small town country lawyer in Dayton, Washington, and that's where I raised my family. I've been married now for 47 years and I have 2 children and 5 grandchildren. When I was a lawyer, I represented and learned a lot about people and certainly about businesses and their challenges and issues. For example, representing the hospital district, representing the port district, representing the school district for a while, really gave me a background that was important once I got to the legislature, more than I thought it would. I've served on many, many committees, including transportation, judiciary, rules. Currently, I'm on the Technology and Energy Committee, and energy is very important, I think, especially to this district, and I'm currently ranking on the Finance Committee. What's important to this district? Agriculture, certainly education, small businesses are my priority. We have some very complex issues in the state right now. That's the reason I decided to run again, is I want to see those answers come from us who are in the legislature at this time to solve them. And we have 2 years more in this term to do so. So thank you.
Thank you. We're gonna start with our warm-up question. Timer, 30 seconds each. Just go right down. Excluding the Bible, what is the most recent book you've read or are currently reading?
Well, yeah, it's not really a book, but it's something that I picked up last week when I was in Winnipeg at a Rotary conference. It was all about about peace and working with conflict resolution. And it's fascinating, and it really it's not a push for Rotary, but it really is. It has a lot to do with everyday life, and I'm looking forward to finishing the book and being a little more adept on some of the tricks on getting that squared away.
Thank you, Mrs. Franzen.
I'm actually reading two books right now. The first is by Richard Dufour called The Case for Public Education. It's an extremely good look at where public education in America really is. And contrary to what you hear on the radio and on newspapers, we are not failing. We are doing better than we have ever done. Unfortunately, the education model has changed and we need to do better than we have ever done. The other thing that I'm listening to, having spent a lot of time on the road between here, Walla Walla, and Prosser, is a book by Laurie R. King. She writes mysteries, and I love mysteries and trying to figure things out.
Thank you. Mr. Neely.
Well, I just finished a book, and now I'm just starting a new book. So the book I just finished was Looking for Allah and Finding Jesus. The reason I picked that book, my wife recommended, was I wanted to learn about Muslims and how they think and how their religion works. And it certainly is laid out in that book. The book I'm reading now is a biography, biography of Andrew Hamilton.
Thank you. And Mr. Downing.
You know, I used to read a lot of things about politics because I've studied politics for 40 years. But, you know, recently, I've really got into Catherine Coulter in her FBI series, or, you know, Lee Child in his Jack Reacher series. I look at the idea that, you know, we can't go ahead and concentrate on politics all the time, right?
Okay, I'm a Jack Reacher fan too. Okay, so here's your first serious question, and I'm going to ask it of all four of you, and we will start with Mrs. Franzik answering first. What is your plan to make sure that K-12 education is fully funded?
Well, first of all, I think we need to look at what revenue streams we are currently using to fund education. When we were on this panel in the primaries, Skylar Rood said only 1.4% of our DNR, Department of Natural Resources funds, were actually going into education. And if that is true, I want to know why that's true. We have a lottery set up. Where is that money going? We have corporations who have tax breaks. How many kids are they putting in the school systems that is burdening our school system without paying the taxes that we might need to fund them? Those are all things that I think we really need to look at. What are the current revenues we have? And where's the shortfall at? And who is it that most benefits? So that's where I would start. I also think that we can do a little bit more partnering, especially at the high school level with our community colleges. You've heard other people up here say that we need a little bit different approach to education. I happen to agree with that. We do need to have more vocational certification and apprenticeship type programs, because even though in 1970, 7 out of 10 kids could drop out of high school and live a middle class life. In 2030, 0.7 children are going to be able to drop out of post-secondary education. That's not high school, that's post-secondary education, and have a middle-class life. So the need for education has never been greater, but that doesn't strictly mean a college degree.
Thank you. Same question, Mr. Jenkins.
Yes, thank you very much. You know, K-12 and a lot has been said what's going on as far as, and I'm sure we'll be getting to the McCleary decision, but the legislature has and Terry helped me with this, $4 billion over the last 3 years has been put into education. And that seems to get lost in all the dollars and everything that's moving around. So we really do need to push for oversight as far as where these dollars are going and what they're appropriated to, so that they're spent correctly. We also need to help get it involved with the local. We need to get education as local, everything as local as possible, and I think we can save some money in that respect. There needs to be choice in education which can reduce cost, and that will go a long way. Who knows what's going to happen with the local levies?
I know in Prosser we passed a fantastic levy, and I don't know where that's going to go once we start talking about levy equalization and that type of thing. But there are ways of fully funding K through 12, and I truly believe we can do that without raising taxes. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Downing, please answer this next.
Thank you. Actually, I look at the idea that after working in the Richland School District for 30 years, I face a lot of the problems that we actually see that come from our legislature. One of the problems that we had, and I'm not alone in this, because when I actually retired June of 2015, my paycheck was less than what it was 10 years before. And that's not just me. That was teachers. That was groundspeople. That was cooks. That was custodians. That was everybody in the district. That means that for some reason, our education system has not been going up. It's simply been going down. That's because they haven't been working as hard as they should be, as hard as they said they worked. I look at the idea that right now, we need to have certified teachers. We need to make sure our teachers have degrees. There shouldn't be a teacher in that classroom without a degree and certification. We ought to have less testing. We don't need to be testing our kids every week. You know, most of us who are my age or maybe a little less, I'm sure there's a lot of people here a lot younger than I am. You know, I look at the idea that we didn't get tested every day, every week. We got tested every once in a while. And you know something? We didn't turn out too bad. I think that if we're going to go ahead and take care of education, we have a couple of routes. We can take the profits out of the lotto, which originally was supposed to be for education. There may not be a lot there because after your store owners and everything get paid, there's probably not a lot, but let's put that money into an education file. And then let's also take what we're receiving now from the marijuana tax revenue. 3 months ago, marijuana tax revenue would definitely help out. So. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Neely.
Well, thank you. Our state constitution says that the legislature shall fully fund K-12 education, and that's a paramount duty of the legislature. Right now, we are the only state in the United States that has that requirement, that strict, and it frankly binds us as a legislature, especially the way the Supreme Court ruled in the McCleary decision. So we've got to deal with it, and it's very, very difficult. First of all, education K-12 takes a huge part of the budget. It's roughly 48% of the budget. So we're talking billions of dollars. And yes, we have put over $4 billion into education K-12 in the last 3.5 or 4 years. That's transportation, full-day kindergarten, and MSOCs. And still, because of the levy unequalization right now, the Supreme Court says we've got to make it fair. Because in Pasco, you got to raise $4 per thousand to get the same amount of money that Bellevue District raises $1 to get the same amount. That's the problem. That's the challenge that we've got to resolve. And so we're going to have to come up with some type of equalization across the state, and we've been working on that all summer to come up with a solution. We're not quite there, but we're coming up with some solutions, but there may have to be some extra revenue to backfill the districts that end up not gaining as a result of whatever the legislature's decision is.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to stick with education for one more question, and position one, Mr. Jenkin, would you go first on this? I'm just going to ask it of these two. What is your stance on the Washington Dream Act and perhaps putting more money into allowing undocumented students to receive financial aid to attend universities and technical colleges?
Can you read the question again, please?
Sure. What is your stance on the Washington Dream Act and on putting more money into allowing undocumented students to receive financial aid to attend universities and technical colleges?
Well, I think it's important that everybody gets an education. And I being on the school board, I truly believe that. However, I feel that it's something that has to be earned. And if you're here illegally, I don't really think that you've earned it. I just don't agree with spending my tax dollars on undocumented unless they come here legally in the ways that's set out. We already have it. Everything is down on how things should go as far as immigration is concerned, and that's my belief on that.
Thank you. Mrs. Francis.
Well, I think we can all agree that the immigration issue at the federal level, which state legislators cannot fix, but it is broken and it does need to be addressed and it does impact this area. One thing that you should know is the money that you put into education is not just lost tax dollars. Economists are going to tell you that the higher a state's education levels, the greater their wealth, the higher the quality of life for their citizens. So putting money into education is a really good investment because you get a lot of positive return for it. As far as the Washington Dream Act, when you have students who are brought here as small children, and they have absolutely no say in whether they're legal or illegal, and they go through the whole entire school system, and then you truncate them at the high school level, what future do they have? And how can they continue to contribute to our community? So yes, the immigration issue does need to be addressed, but that is a federal problem. But those students who are already here, who have already been invested in our K-12 system, deserve the chance to go on and earn an education and become productive members of our society.
Thank you. Okay, position two, and Mr. Neely, you'll go first. We're going to move to voter registration. It was in the local newspaper just the other day that Washington State is not in compliance with a 2005 federal law called Real ID that requires state driver's licenses and ID cards to have security enhancements and be issued to people who can prove they are legally in the United States. Last week, our Secretary of State here in Washington proposed legislation to correct this so that election officials can ensure that non-citizens are not trying to register to vote. The issue has come up in previous legislative sessions, but lawmakers have been unsuccessful in passing that legislation. If you are reelected to the state legislature, would you support or oppose such legislation? Why or why not?
That's a long question.
I know.
that's a long statement, but if I can boil it down to what I understand it to be, I think we're one of two states that do not have the registration. Isn't that right? Or did you say that?
Actually, we're the only one.
Or maybe we're the only state left. I would support the legislation because sooner or later, we're going to be left out in the cold, and those driver's licenses that we have are going to be worthless in regards to ID. So I would support the legislation that would make those IDs available and support our Secretary of State's position on that.
Thank you. Mr. Downing, if you're elected, would you support or oppose this legislation?
I would definitely support the idea. When somebody goes and gets a driver's license as a citizen, that person should be able to have the right to vote. I look at the idea that it's a registration, basically, to vote. And some people have not voted for that. They voted against it.
Okay. Thank you. This next question is for all four of you, and we will start with you, Mr. Jenkin. And believe me, I worked on this so that each one of you is having an equal opportunity to answer something first. So, Mr. Jenkin, if you'd go first on this. This past summer, Governor Jerry Brown of California signed legislation that includes imposing new restrictions on assault weapons and regulating the sale of ammunition. We know this is a huge subject, but would you please explain your beliefs about gun control specifically including what role should be played by the state versus the federal government?
Okay, thank you for the question. First of all, I have been endorsed by the NRA, and I, as far as Governor Gary Brown, I'm just so glad to be out of that state. I'll start with that. Been here for about 10 years, and that's why I left that state, was because of things like this. I really believe that when we start restricting firearms and we start going up the ladder, pretty soon there our gun rights and the Second Amendment is going to be gone. So when we start restricting, we have to really, really be careful of the restrictions and on what. I totally believe that we don't need anybody having a bazooka or something of that nature that's going to cause that type of damage, but we need to protect ourselves. And what was the second part of the question?
Well, what role should be played by the state versus the federal government?
Well, the state and the federal have to form partnerships on what's best for us. We need to work together. I'm just tired. That's why I'm running is so that we can reach out and we can form partnerships, we can work together, and we can have reasonable regulations, and that way we can have reasonable results.
Thank you. Mrs. Francik.
Thank you. Well, first of all, I grew up on a farm, and we had weapons on our farm. We used them to butcher, so we killed pigs, we killed sheep, we killed beef cows, and my dad would take me hunting on the weekends, and we would shoot pheasants. So I am not unfamiliar with the hunting culture. However, I also have a son who is a major in the Air Force, and every time he comes off the field or off of his training base, he has to put his assault weapons into a locker. He doesn't get to bring them home, and he doesn't get to carry them around on the streets. So I am a little concerned. I'm not against people having hunting weapons. I'm not even against people having a personal handgun. But I do not understand how we got to the point where we have military-grade weapons in the hands of just everyday people. I don't think that's where they belong. As far as how the state is going to work with the federal government, it is a federal legislation with the Second Amendment rights, but I think states have proven that they start taking action and then often that drives federal legislation. So in this particular case, I would be supporting the regulation of assault weapons and limiting ammunition. And I would like to just say one more thing. People keep saying we can't do anything because it is going to be the death knell of people having their Second Amendment rights. But we have regulations in everything. You cannot drive 80 miles an hour down the freeway. It doesn't keep you from having a car and being able to drive. You can't drive impaired by drugs, but that doesn't mean you can't take prescription drugs when you need them. So a little regulation isn't going to be the end.
Thank you. Mr. Neely.
I'm a strong supporter of the Second Amendment rights. I think that's very important. I think the issue here is assault weapons, and my concern is where do you draw the line? Where do you draw the line? Handguns, shotguns, repeating rifles, assault weapons. That's difficult. And of course, the old adage is, well, you know, you use them to protect yourself. The bad guys will certainly have them, so do we need to match that with being able to keep assault weapons ourselves? When Sandy Hook happened, when these other massive shootings happened, I think our hearts all reached out with, gosh, what a terrible incident. What can we do about it? What can we do to slow down the guns issue? But when you really take a step back and look at it, it's very, very difficult without taking these very, very basic rights away from our citizens. In regards to the second part of the question, can the state have their own, you know, rules or laws passed? Certainly they can. I would certainly suggest that we dovetail as closely as we can with the federal laws. We can have background checks, etc. And I'll also say that, in fact, it's an initiative this year about courts. If there's an extreme situation that comes up where a judge rules or has in front of him a situation where he can rule there's an extreme risk, He can rule that weapons can be taken away from that person. I support that.
Thank you. And Mr. Downing.
I also support that initiative. I think it's a good one. I believe that, and, you know, this is a federal issue. It really is. And I look at the idea that realistically, we need to make sure that people are protected. I'm not saying that we take everybody's guns. I mean, for crying out loud, it's a federal issue. And I have guns of my own. Am I going to be stupid enough to pass a law that says, take your guns? I think that people need to be realistic about this. An assault weapon is not out there to go ahead to actually kill a deer. Come on. What do you need an assault rifle for? I used to go out on the rifle range all the time and fire off, you know, rounds and actually come up with an expert, you know, rating. It's things like that. But that's military. This is here. This is civilian life. We're looking at the idea of facing, we're just looking at the idea of facing life. Let the police take care of the problems. We have our own weapons at home. I'm not giving them away.
Thank you. Okay, I have a question here from the audience that I'm going to ask position one to answer, and Mrs. Francik, you'll go first. Do you support legislation that would make farmers pay overtime to migrant farm workers when those workers work more than 40 hours in a week?
Wow, I wasn't prepared for this question. Okay, I think that if we require every other business in the state of Washington to pay overtime over 40 hours, then farmers should not be exempt.
Thank you. Mr. Jenkins.
Well, I agree with that. I feel that anybody that works overtime should be awarded pay for overtime. I know I pay my employees for any overtime that they give. So, yes, I agree.
Thank you. Getting ahead of me here. Okay. Next question will go to position two candidates. And as soon as I find it, okay. This is another one from the audience. I think you can both give your opinion on this. What is your opinion of the district-based city council? I think you're both aware of the that we had a vacancy here in Pasco and they had to decide to redistrict now or later and so forth. I don't know all the details, so I'm not going to try to say them. Are you both familiar with this?
Somewhat, yes.
Okay, so Mr. Downing, we'll let you go first.
Well, I think that the idea of the redistricting was the fact of actually having equal votes or equal voices in the community. And you know something? That's something that's very important. I don't care who you are in this community. Everybody has to have an equal voice.
Thank you. Mr. Neely?
Well, I remember this question coming up when we sat right here when we were running for the primary. I remember Mrs. Francik answering, and I thought very well and very accurately, for the city of Pasco to attempt to, as I recall, increase their number of districts or increase their number on the board, which I thought was a good idea and would meet the requirement. Otherwise, that gives more of a variance across the district for people to vote. So it's more difficult to have one area that would be affected that way. It'd be more equal across the board. The question is also asked whether that would apply to every city in the state, and it wouldn't really. Most cities and towns don't have the diversity, for example, that Pasco does and some of our other cities do. They certainly need to pay closer attention to it to make sure that each vote throughout the district is fair and equal.
Thank you. Okay, this next question is for all four of you, and we will, the one place where we got to go back to back, Mr. Neely, you'll be first on this one. It's about climate change. Another initiative on the November ballot is Initiative 732, also called the carbon tax. This is a direct tax and is revenue neutral. It places a direct $25 a ton tax on carbon, making fuels more expensive and thereby disincentivizing their use. Concurrently, it lowers the state sales tax by 1%. Do you believe this is an effective means to address climate change?
I do not, for various reasons. I remember when this issue came before our finance committee, and the very first proponent admitted that it was not a fair tax because it gave Boeing Company a great big large B&O tax credit, which they already have had a large B&O tax credit. And basically, here's how it works, is that there is a surcharge, you might say, or a tax for, I'm going to say, polluters, which means that whatever electricity they use or power they use, is if it's provided by coal or some other fossil fuel, they're deemed to be a polluter. And therefore, they are charged, and I think it starts at $12 a metric ton, and over the years, it goes up to $100 a metric ton. That no company probably can last very long if they kept continuing emitting the carbon. But it's only because of the electricity they purchase. And so they get a B&O tax credit, supposedly about the same rate as to what they're paying in the carbon tax, but it's never quite revenue neutral, never quite matches up. The other segment of society that gets hit is, of course, anybody who drives an automobile. So I think there is definitely climate change. I think that we need to address our carbon emissions, but this is not going to work. So I'm going to vote against it, and I would urge you to vote against it.
Thank you, Mr. Downing.
Well, it's something I really haven't taken into consideration a lot, but I've heard about it, you know. And what Terry just mentioned as far as giving Boeing bigger breaks on something that they don't really need, you know, I can understand that. I understand that we do have climate change. I mean, you can take a look at the weather outside every time you turn around. Do we have to address that with a carbon tax? You know, I think that maybe there are people out there that know a lot more about carbon tax than I do. And while I've been trying to learn everything I can as to what I'm going to have to do in the legislature, that's one thing I haven't brushed up on completely. So I'm going to say that right now, I'm going to leave it up to the general population.
Okay, thank you. Mrs. Francik.
Earlier it was mentioned that initiatives often have unintended consequences, and I think that this is an initiative where we do really have to wonder who are the winners, who are the losers, and how does this really work. My biggest concern about climate change, and I also think that the scientific evidence shows it's definitely changing, is that if we're going to start trying to develop programs to mitigate it, we need really good scientific data that shows us and gives us metrics that if we do this, this is going to be the result. And I don't think that that's what this initiative accomplishes at this point, so I will not be voting for it. I will say, though, that I am a big supporter of nuclear fuel, which not everybody is. It is certainly a much cleaner fuel than carbon, carbon. And I also support renewable resources.
Thank you. And Mr. Jenkin.
Yes. You know, the impacts of this is huge. Things like the paper plant. What are they going to do if it passes? Somebody who I was talking to, that's one of the biggest businessmen in the state of Washington, Gary Christensen, the owner of RP Powell, he's talking about what it'll do to his business. Matter of fact, he's already selling some of the businesses that he has that are on the line because of impacts that he thinks may happen if it does pass. So I really think it's going to have a very, very negative impact on not only small businesses, but also large businesses. Climate change, you know, there's a lot of questions about that. Is it happening or is it not? I tend to believe that it most likely is, but we don't know, and I don't know. So, and getting back to what Mary had said, as far as things like this really need to be ironed out in the legislature, and I feel that that's where this belongs. So I'm definitely voting no on this.
Thank you. Okay, our last question is on campaign finance reform. I'm going to ask it of all four of you, and Mr. Downing, you'll go first. Well, or wait a minute, did I do that backwards?
I'm gonna make sure this mic's working.
Okay, I think I did it right. I've got you.
I look at the
order.
Idea.
Wait a minute. I'm gonna give you a little background here.
Okay.
Whether you want it or not.
Go for it.
Initiative 1464, which has to do with money in politics, is also on the November ballot. It is said that the intent of this initiative is to increase transparency and accountability to the public in Washington state by 1, limiting campaign contributions by lobbyists, thus limiting their influence; 2, preventing corruption or the perception of corruption by strengthening campaign contribution limits; and 3, promoting citizen participation and open political discussion by empowering small donors. Are you in favor of campaign finance reform as addressed in this initiative, or do you have some other ideas to accomplish effective campaign finance reform?
Okay, that's not the same as 735. That's 1464. Well, I look at the idea that some of the things that you were talking about in there need to be addressed. But if I look at the idea of also supporting 735, basically we're talking about the same thing pretty much. Talking about amending Citizens United. Is that correct?
That was the corporations.
You see, I'm for amending Citizens United, because corporations are not people. And I don't care what anybody says, a corporation should not have a voice. The individuals working for that corporation might have a voice, but not the corporation.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Neely.
Well, let's back up just a minute. There are two initiatives on the ballot that address campaign financing. And then we heard the question earlier of the 8th District members about 735. That is actually an initiative that requires or asks or requests our federal congressmen and women to go back and overturn Citizens United. That's all it really does. 1464 addresses our state, and I'm not opposed to it. I think we need to have reasonable campaign financing. The reason I'm not really opposed to it is we have it already. There's a limitation by dollar amounts, what can be contributed to, for example, the representatives, the Senate, and so forth, senators. It's $1,000 for general right now, and the same for primary right now, and that can go up. But at least there are limitations, and they have to be reported to the PDC, Public Disclosure Commission, and that's all on record. So I really don't think this initiative is going to make that much difference. No matter what we do, whether it passes or not, the law is not going to change much.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Jenkins.
Yes. I believe in transparency, and I too believe that 1464 is not a bad way to go. Like Terry said, $1,000 per session isn't that per cycle isn't that much money when you're looking at the overall scheme of things. I mean, by God, in the primary, I had to sell a duplex to get through that because I wasn't known. I was the person from the outside that nobody knew, none of the parties, none of you. And so in order to get my message out, I had to, like I say, sell a duplex and spend a whole lot of my savings, because I'm passionate enough about being here in front of you and getting things solved and getting things done in Olympia. It's worth that much to me. So, and I don't have any regrets. So I am in favor of this, and from experience. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mrs. Francis.
Well, one of the things that politicians continually talk about is how do we get people more interested in the political process? And I will tell you that one of the biggest blocks to being part of the political process is money. So if you have to raise $60,000, $80,000, $100,000, and you are not a person of wealth and you don't have a duplex to sell, you're pretty much out of the game unless you can convince an awful lot of people in your community to kick in $3, $4, $5. I agree with what Representative Neely said. The transparency is already there. If you want to see what any one of us are spending, all you have to do is go to the Public Disclosure Commission in the state of Washington. We're all registered. You can see what we make annually. You can see what we've raised, who gave it to us, and how we've spent it. If you're going to limit contributions by lobbyists, people that are giving you money, then you also have to limit the amount of money that can be given by personal finances, because otherwise you again are putting people that do not come from wealth at a disadvantage. So I will not be supporting this. I do think, though, that if I get elected, one of the things I would like to see is putting a cap on how much you can spend for a position. If you have a position like the one I'm running for that pays $48,500 a year, maybe you should only be able to spend up to $20,000 to run for that position. If you're running for the governor, and I don't know what his salary is, but maybe you can only spend up to half of that salary. That might be one way to kind of cap the money.
Thank you. I actually have one more question that was under my papers from the audience. So we're going to go quick. Just going to go right down the line again. This doesn't count as being in order. But this is from the audience, and let's take 30 seconds on this. I know it's a very deep subject, but just give us your opinion. Would you support a more pragmatic approach in Olympia, or are the divisions between left and right too deep?
We need to have common sense. We need to be able to work with both sides of the aisle. We need to work with, not relent to, but we need to develop consensus. There's a lot of passionate people over there. In my opinion, it's not about right, it's not about left, it's what's best. And that's what we have to use to guide ourselves.
Thank you, Mrs. Francis.
So I've worked on the Pasco City Council for 19 years. This is a nonpartisan position, so 19 years of my political life has been solution-driven. What is the problem? How do we get to consensus? And how do we move forward from there? I will tell you that I think the biggest problem with people who sometimes go into the political process is they have to win. That's not how you get ahead in the political process. You decide where you have things that you can agree on. So Mr. Neely, I've been in his office. I've been in Maureen Walsh's office. There are things that they can help us with. There are things that they can't help us with. It's not a winner-take-all. It's how do we find consensus and move forward.
Thank you. Mr. Neely.
I'll begin by saying I think it's really necessary to have political parties. There's a lot of reasons for that we don't have time to get into. But I have a great reputation of being probably one of the main pragmatists, if that's a word, in Olympia. I guess I've been trained as a lawyer too long. I want to fix problems, and that's my number one goal of being in Olympia.
Thank you. Mr. Downing.
Well, I believe anybody that goes into the legislature needs to be able to work with others. I've spent most of my life serving with other people and taking care of their problems. I think that being in Olympia is something that's going to be very important. You can't go in there and just say, well, this is the way it's going to be, guys. You have to have a little bit of discretion, and you have to work, and you have to work together with others.
Thank you. Okay, we'll now move to closing statements. You have 1 minute. Up to 1 minute to make a closing statement. And Mr. Neely, you will be first.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you. Well, I've served in the legislature now for 7 years, so my strong point is experience. I've had experience on a lot of committees. I'm on some important committees right now that's going to be faced with some big decisions this next session. I'm ready to tackle it again for another 2 years. Some people ask me why, but I've really felt that there are rewards there. The rewards are the sense of accomplishment, and the rewards are you can really do something. You can accomplish something for a whole lot of people, for millions of people, and that is very satisfactory when everything comes together and you get a bill passed that really does improve our society and our state and our constituents back home. So I feel very honored to have served you so far. I'd like your support and vote for 2 more years. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Downing.
You know, over the last 30 years while I've worked in the Richland School District, I've had the opportunity to work on many issues, problems, and things, and come up with positive, achievable results. I look at the idea that I could have just retired and just gone out and traveled and done all the things like that. But you know, when you spend most of your life working for people and doing things for them, you just don't stop. And that's one of the reasons I'm running for the legislature right now. We have an education problem that needs to be fixed. We have homeless problems in this district that are not being taken care of. We have jobs and economy problems. We have small business and small farmers that need help. And I'm going to do everything I can to make that happen, to work for those people. I'm Gary Downing, and I'm running for the 16th Legislative District, seat number 2, and I hope that I'll have your support and your vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Jenkins.
Yes, I would like to finish off on something that I didn't get to finish on the opening. I am married. I've got 3 kids and 3 grandkids. Now, I live the issues of small business. I live the education. I live agriculture through my businesses and my position of the school board president every day. I know what needs to be done to create jobs and improve our children's education. I'm familiar with our farmers' needs as I'm in agriculture myself. I have 30 years of community service and have been able to thrive in the private sector my entire life. We need to elect a candidate with experience and leadership skills to represent the voters of the 16th district. I and others believe that I'm the logical choice, and I humbly ask for your vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Mrs. Francik.
When you get your ballot, you're going to see that Rebecca Francik is running as a Democrat. This is not usually considered an advantage in the 16th Legislative District. So before you vote, I want you to consider, our region does not have a single voice that represents our area in the majority Democratic caucus in Olympia. Consider the disadvantage of having all our representation restricted to one party. I don't know about you, but in my life, I spread my risk factors. In the past, legislators elected without local government or education experience have hurt our towns and schools by diverting the Public Works Trust Fund into the general fund, depriving our communities of low-interest loans for local infrastructure needs. They have taken our share of liquor revenues, depriving our towns of funding that we count on for local public safety needs, and they have failed to fully fund education, which led to a teacher strike in Pasco last year. If you believe that local government experience will benefit you at the state level, please vote for Rebecca Francik. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. And I would like to thank all 4 candidates for taking the time to be with us tonight. Let's give them a round of applause. We'll take a quick break and have the Franklin County Commissioner candidates come on up. Okay, welcome to the candidates for Franklin County Commissioner. Running for position 1, we have Matt Beaton and Brad Peck. And for position 2, we have Bob Cook and Rocky Mullen. Again, let me quickly review the format. 2-minute opening statements. Then we'll have questions and answers with 1.5-minute responses, unless I change that. Both candidates in the same race will be asked the same questions always, alternating who goes first. And trust me, I have my whole little thing here, so it might not seem like you are, but each of you has the opportunity to go first an equal amount of times. Are there any more questions from the audience? I still have one audience question that I saved to ask of the county commissioner candidates. So other than that, good thing I did my homework and got some. Okay, and then a minute for closing. So we're still going to sort of use alphabetical order, and we will begin with position one. And Mr. Beaton, your opening statement, please.
Great, thank you. Thank you to the League of Women Voters, the City of Pasco, and everyone involved in putting this together, and most of all of you for sticking around. I'm Matt Beaton, and I want to be your next commissioner from District 1. I want to start right off by saying Franklin County has a bright future if we emphasize community collaboration and work to make sure that everyone is included and heard from in our local government. We can, and I will, deliver better government. I've been your elected county auditor for the past 6 years, and I've worked with the community in elections outreach, collaborated with electeds and fellow directors in the courthouse to install software, and worked with the auditor staff to improve county government in both the public works track and in the implementation of our software. I have a degree from the University of Washington. I serve on the local Lord's Foundation board, and I'm a member of the Pasco Kiwanis. I have the track record, temperament, and experience to work with everyone in the courthouse and across the river to deliver on my three main priorities. Number one, I want to rebuild the failing bi-county partnerships. Number two, I want to increase transparency through a commitment to open government. And number three, I want to bring back integrity in the spending and budgeting process at Franklin County. In this election, we can make this happen. I'm committed to it. You see, Franklin County is my home and has been since 1995. Lisa and I got married. We're raising four children here. I have a senior at Chiawana all the way down to little Juliana, who's 2 years old. We've been at this for 18 years, and we aren't going anywhere. Please help me to bring better government to Franklin County and our community as your next Franklin County Commissioner. Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Peck, your opening statement.
First off, thanks very much to the League of Women Voters for hosting this event. It is very important that we have an informed populace that selects their leaders. I'd like to start out by giving a little bit of my background for those who may not have met me. I have a bachelor's degree from Central Washington University, a master's degree from Eastern Washington University. I'm an Air Force Lieutenant Colonel, retired, served for 21 years on active duty, including tours of duty in the Middle East and numerous Middle East countries. Worked in the Pentagon as a personal hand-picked advisor to members of the Joint Chiefs of Staff on a variety of issues. I've worked in high-tech classified space programs, just a whole broad range of experiences, literally around the country and around the world. I retired in 2003 to return back to Washington. When I got back to Washington, I spent about 6 years working in commercial nuclear power, also developing renewable energy systems, wind, solar, and hydro. Finished there as the assistant to the CEO at that company and also as an executive project manager. My wife, Deborah, and I have been married for 36 years now. I should make sure I get that one right. We purchased the old Moore Mansion here in Pasco and have made that a passion of ours to restore that and embed ourselves fully in the community. The values that I bring to my job as a commissioner are the same ones that I was brought up with in the Air Force, and they're very straightforward. It's integrity first, service before self, and excellence in all we do. And those values are translated at the county level in the work that I do, and that my personal standards are that everything we do in the county is and must be legal, ethical, and moral. That means we treat everyone equitably and fairly, and it's about service, not self.
Thank you. Mr. Cook.
Thank you. Good evening. I I am Bob Cook, and the Franklin County Commissioner is District 2. I appreciate everybody being here. Thank you for the forum. It's good to have the information out where everybody can see it, be informed voters. With that, a little background on myself. I am married to my wife, Connie. We'll be 40 years this January. We have two girls and two grandkids. So my background was self-employed businessman for near 40 years before I had a fire accident. During that time, part of that time was a volunteer fire chief for the city of Connell and Franklin County Fire District 1. I had about 20 years with District 1 and about 12, I think, with the city of Connell. So a little diversified area under that. I had 50 firefighters to work with. And, as I said, been in this commission for a number of years, and I appreciate the time that you have given me here. I enjoy what I do. I have a lot of history with the county, and I come from the North County. I'm a Connell resident, and I think it's quite important to keep a North County commissioner on staff. So, thank you.
Thank you. And Mr. Mullen.
My name is Rocky Mullen, and I am running for Franklin County Commissioner District 2. I am a lifelong resident of Franklin County. My father, John Mullen, was number 7 in the drawing when they opened up the Basin Project. I was very blessed to have grown up in Franklin County on the family farm and raising livestock. I owe it to my father for my strong work ethic and strong Christian family values. It is that strong commitment and work ethic that has got me to where I am today. I attended Eastern Washington University while working for Safeway Stores Incorporated and entered their management team at the age of 19. I then went on to manage a store for 8 years. I then moved on and worked for Bluebell Potato Chip Company as territorial sales manager for the western part of the state of Montana. In 1996, I started a western entertainment company here in the Tri-Cities that went nationwide. I had clients that include Sony Studios, Columbia Pictures, the U.S. Army. I even did the Super Bowl party in Houston before the pregame. I have also owned and operated Sahara Pizza in Pasco for the past 13 years. My wife and I also own Dove Financial Services here in Pasco, where we purchase other businesses' accounts receivables. It is this experience that I bring with me as I seek your vote for County Commissioner. I know what it takes to run a successful business, from budgeting to controlling costs to negotiating and empowering the right people to get the job done. And get the job done right. I look forward to the challenges as county commissioner and working with the other electeds to accomplish the goals of Franklin County. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, you four are not going to get away without answering the question about the book. So we're going to start with you, Mr. Mullen. Excluding the Bible, what is the most recent book you've read or are currently reading?
The most current book I am reading is How to Win by Sean McGrath.
Thank you.
I am new to the political scene, so as with anything that I'm going to undertake, I start to do the research. And
thank you. Mr. Cook.
Most recent actually was last winter. I don't get a chance to read much during the summer, but The Boys in a Boat has to do with our team, rowing team out of Washington State. I'm sorry, the Huskies, and going to the Olympics in Germany in the late 30s, and so.
Thank you. Mr. Peck.
Geez, Bob, you couldn't find a book on cougars?
Yeah.
So recently had the opportunity to briefly meet Charles Krauthammer and got a signed copy of his book, Things That Matter, and that's what I'm just starting into now.
Thank you. And Mr. Beaton.
I recently purchased a book by John Wooden. He was the basketball coach at UCLA from the mid-40s to the mid-70s. Had a 12-year run where he won 10 national championships at UCLA. The book is Wooden on Leadership, How to Create a Winning Organization.
Oh, I like all of your choices. And I've read two of them. Okay. Our first question for all of you, and we'll begin with Mr. Beaton, is this. Both Benton and Franklin counties are reportedly negotiating an agreement to consolidate 911 emergency response operations. This is a long-standing effort supported widely by community and emergency responders. Do you support this? And if so, what would you do to make this a reality in the shortest time possible?
Thank you. I have had been fortunate enough, actually after I filed, to attend one of the CCOM meetings and read quite a few of the documents put out by our current sheriff as well as the board on the issue. This is one of the bi-county relationships that's critical. This has been going on for 10 years, and clearly they're at loggerheads as they can't seem to sort out whether it's a subscriber, whether they will have a vote. And thankfully, we had the wisdom to bring in somebody who, Steve Renke, who could make some solutions. And my understanding is we are very close to resolving that. It's badly needed as our internal systems in the 911 area, you know, with the software and the equipment, we're on a shoestring at this point. And I understand the very need for it. As technology advances, I believe I read there's somewhere in the area of 5,000 calls. It can't be a day, but there's a large number of calls are routed to the wrong center. So yes, I support it. One of the reasons I'm running is I think this should have had a much greater priority. I'm glad to see we've brought in some collaboration through Steve Renke, who's can bring the sides together, and I hope we can get it done. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Peck.
So yes, I do support it. It's one of the more important bi-county operations that we have available to us. Mr. Beaton said it's at loggerheads. That's incorrect. We're actually probably in the 11th hour or beyond in coming to a solution. I said we can't decide if it's a subscriber or a vote. Actually, it is a membership where we'll be full partners with them. And because it's a critical function for both the counties, it needs to be a partnership, not a subscriber relationship. Mr. Renke, who I participated as one of the people that worked on bringing him in, has done an excellent job for us and has overcome a lot of the political entrenchment, if you will, from all parties involved, and has helped clarify the interests of everybody and find common ground. So that's worked really well. There have been some misrouted calls just because a cell phone call can hit a tower that may be in across the river in another county where you don't need that service. In fact, that happened to me just the other day. I called 911 for a woman who needed an ambulance. Bottom line, it's a critical program. We are very, very close. I'll be surprised if we don't have an agreement in place by the end of this year and start actually putting it together physically early in 2017. And lastly, I'll just say that we're going to be able to do all this, improve the quality of service, and I believe either maintain current costs or reduce them slightly. It's been a great team effort between CCOM, Benton County, Franklin County, and all the parties involved. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Cook?
Yes, I very definitely support it. As I mentioned, I spent a number of years in the volunteer fire service. Back when I first started, our communication was phone calls and phone trees, and I've watched the communications grow through the last 30 years. So, yeah, it's always been, you know, the fire service is under a different radio system, basically, or a different frequency than the law enforcement, but It's been a dilemma with law enforcement back and forth with CECOM and Franklin County because of the different systems that they're both are using. So looking very much forward to seeing this come to a reality and get implemented. I think it's a win-win for all of law enforcement.
Thank you. Mr. Mullen.
Yes, I do support it. I believe that all the issues that happen here in the Tri-Cities are not bound by the river, and I think that a system like this should have been in place a long time ago. I believe that we definitely need it and work together for it.
Okay. Our next question will be just for the position one candidates. This is a question from the audience, and Mr. Peck, I'd like you to go first. How do you feel about the discrepancy between Washington state laws versus federal laws, most specifically Washington voters' right to act and hence the ACLU lawsuit in Pasco?
Okay, let me have the second half of that again, please, Kay.
Okay, well, I think we're talking about the redistricting that the ACLU was involved with.
Okay, all right.
Is that right, audience?
I think I get the gist of the question. So an elected official's first and maybe last responsibility is to serve the best interests of the people that elected them, their bosses. And on, thankfully, rare occasions, they find themselves in a position where you've got two different authorities, state law and federal law, that conflict. And it's the duty of those elected officials to look at that and try and parse out what best serves the interests of that community. Specifically with Pasco in the voting districts, there's recent judicial experience in Yakima that shows that the federal law is going to trump state law on district voting. And I said last night at the Pasco City Council meeting, the public comment period, I commended the City Council and thanked them for their wisdom. They've, as the question suggests, it presents a very, very difficult situation, and they've done, an admirable job of walking through that mess, that conflict between state and federal law. Whether you agree that a particular majority-minority population is advantaged or disadvantaged. If you can provide additional opportunity for those populations without taking something away from another population, then it seems to me that that's a prudent, pragmatic, and responsible thing to do, and I commend the City Council for their work on that.
Thank you. Mr. Beaton, same question.
Would you repeat it?
Sure. How do you feel about the discrepancy between Washington state laws versus federal laws, most specifically Washington voters, I'm not sure I'm reading this right, right to act and hence the ACLU lawsuit in Pasco? Has to do with the redistricting.
Sure. No, I've been right at the center of it. I just was trying to figure out what the question was. And so having been as auditor right at the center, I've met with many groups, I've had correspondence with the city, with the PA, and that was the unique position that as the administrator of the elections that we were in, I believe everybody understood it. And I am glad to see that they were able to get to a resolution. I was fortunate enough to sit in on several of the meetings with the ACLU, and as the ex officio supervisor of elections for Franklin County, this happened exactly the way it should. This is Pasco's, this is Pasco's election, and they should work to find solutions for their community. The fact that we are actually, my understanding is that they're lobbying the federal the judge to try or taking their position to try to move forward in that manner, and I support it. There's 7 elected officials, and they're doing what's best for their people. So I'm glad they're working through the process as it is.
Thank you. Okay, position 2 candidates, and Mr. Mullen, you'll go first. We got 2 questions from the audience on this subject. What can be done to improve the safety of roads in our community, specifically for pedestrians and cyclists. Can the county do something towards it?
Well, that's a good question. I guess the first thing I would look at is, you know, what are the posted speed limits and what is the safety of the road? And then make some, you know, and look at the past record. I mean, are there certain accidents on certain highways? There's certain areas that are more dangerous than others. I would take a look at all that. And again, look at what the posted speed limits are and make sure that they're in line.
Okay. Mr. Cook?
Yes, as far as bike lanes and pedestrian sidewalks, the county's not in that industry. We don't have city streets, so to speak. I think our probably as far as safety on our county roads is having the bar ditches shallower than we have them at this point, and have them sloped so that if a car does run off the road, its chances of keeping from rolling. In fact, that's some of the safeties that we are going through now. So.
Thank you. Okay, the next question is for all four of you, and Mr. Peck will begin with you. Here's the question. What changes would you propose to the way the current mental health system operates? Do you think the state should take over mental health services from the counties? Why or why not?
No, the state shouldn't take them over. I believe the government that's closest to the people governs best, and I think hearing the people's voice and what their need is best heard at the local level. Certainly there will be state oversight, there will be state guidelines and policy, and there needs to be state funding. We've had enough unfunded mandates. I've made two different proposals during my time as a county commissioner that would have funded, constructed, and fully staffed in perpetuity forever a professional mental health triage facility where law enforcement who encounter people on the street and aren't trained to make an immediate diagnosis as to whether somebody is mentally ill, perhaps physically injured, or maybe is on illegal drugs, or any number of possibilities. We put our law enforcement out in the street and we put them in a situation where they've got to make these kinds of decisions. What we need to do is give them a competent triage facility where they can take the person for their own safety and the public safety, bring them there and have competent professionals decide whether or not this is someone that needs to go to treatment, someone who needs to go to an emergency room for physical health, or someone that is not, in their judgment, mentally ill and can go to jail. We have the capacity to do that, and frankly, we need to stop wasting so much money on incarcerating people whose only crime, and I say that in quotes because it's not a crime, is that they're mentally ill, but we treat them like criminals and we put them in jail. We need to stop doing that. We can provide treatment for less than it costs to incarcerate them. I've made two proposals to do that, and I'll continue to push hard for that.
Thank you. Mr. Beaton.
Would you repeat the question?
Sure.
I'm trying to think, because I got the gist was the distinction
okay.
Between whether state or local.
No. What changes would you propose to the way the current mental health system operates? Do you think the state should take over mental health services from the counties? Why or why not?
So I am eagerly looking forward to Leon Evans' visit from Behar County and the model they're using down there. My understanding is that the state will take over very soon, and I believe it's 2020. What I do support is local control, and I do support the option that I believe the Behar County model presents, which is the diversion and then the multi facets of that. I think for me the biggest part of it is the community collaboration. One of the big reasons I'm in this race is that I want to try to save these bi-county relationships as they're more efficient and better for government. And I believe we have to collaborate and work together as a Tri-Cities community. And that's exactly what I'll do as your next commissioner. So thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Mullen, same question. Do you want me to repeat it?
Sure.
Okay. What changes would you propose to the way the current mental health system operates? Do you think the state should take over mental health services from the counties? Why or why not?
Well, I think that we should try to keep as much local control as we can, but I do see the need that we to take care of our mentally health. I think we need to start a crisis care center that's similar to what they have in Bexar County, Texas. And I think it's putting an overload of burden on our police force, and I think that we can save money in the long run by being an example and going forward and setting this a similar care center in place here in Washington State to be a founder to show the rest of the state, hey, we can do this, we can take control. I don't believe that our police officers should be burdened with this. I think we need a spot where we can take somebody to be evaluated, where they can get the treatment that they need, and then care for them there, and then make the decision of where to place them. But as far as putting them in jail and basically taking away their identity, their medication, and putting them in an isolation cell is not to anyone's benefit.
Thank you. Mr. Cook.
Yes, thank you. It's pretty much have to agree with all three that preceded me, but except for the fact that I don't think the state should take it over. I have seen what they've done with Eastern and Western State Hospital, and it's not been picture perfect by any means. I used to live close to Western State and would drive by there every day to work. And that has gone down, since late 60s when I got over there. So I think local control is the way to go, and as we've talked, bring in that consultant, see where to go from there. The state is mandated, they aren't going to take it over, but they've mandated that behavioral health of some sort will take it over in 2020. How that's going to look is up to us, and hopefully with this consultant coming in, he can direct us in the right path so that we aren't taken over.
Thank you. Okay, this next question will be for the position one candidates, and Mr. Beaton, if you would please go first. In your opinion, should local authorities be the ones to investigate and prosecute shootings by police officers rather than state or federal officials? Why or why not?
I believe the local officials absolutely have a role. I think as we've seen in our community recently, there are other levels that you go up. You can go up from there, but I do believe it depends on the circumstances. And I think the people involved, if there's conflicts of interest or something else, we currently have alternatives for those investigations. But I do believe, by default, you start local and you move from there.
Thank you. Mr. Peck.
So when the National Transportation Safety Board investigates an aircraft accident, they get pilots and aircraft mechanics and people with expertise in that field to do the investigation. And that's why we need law enforcement people to investigate these kinds of situations, because they have the expertise. Having said that, I think it would be exceedingly valuable to get people from outside the local agents, local area, to come in and participate in those reviews and investigations. It still needs to be done at the local level, because keep in mind, we still have people at the state level and at the federal level who can and have shown themselves willing to review and evaluate these investigations, and if deemed appropriate, do their own investigation. So they aren't just done locally. They're done at multiple levels all the way up to the federal government. But I do think that the perception to the public is important, and the trust with the public is exceedingly important. And if we can improve that relationship and that trust level by bringing in people from other counties, or probably not other states, but other counties who could bring law enforcement expertise to the table and help with those investigations, I think that would be productive. I'm not convinced that the current system is incapable of rendering a fair and impartial decision, but I think the public trust is enhanced by bringing in outside expertise. And in the most recent case here in Pasco, it did get reviewed at the state level, state attorney general, and also at the federal level. So I think there's been ample review. Whether you agree with the outcome or not, it's an entirely different subject, but it did get thorough review.
Thank you. Position two, Mr. Cook. Do you agree with the county coroner's decision to hold an inquest on the Zambrano Monte shooting? Why or why not?
I personally don't, I don't feel that he needs to with the, what has come back from all the entities that have looked into it, looked at the records, looked at the films. Starting off with our internal investigation and reams of paper that they've gone through and films and going to the feds to look at it, the judicial system, and then going to the state to look at it. I think the three entities have made their decisions, and I don't think that it needs to go through another inquest.
Mr. Mullen?
I believe if there was going to be an inquest, it should have been done right away. I think that at this point, all the facts are out there and the decision has been made.
Okay, thank you. We'll lighten things up a little here and talk about agriculture. And all four of you and Mr. Mullen, you're going to go first this time. Agriculture is a huge economic booster to the Franklin County economy, yet we have seen available land for farming being bought and used for urban growth in our cities. Do you have a plan to strike a balance to retain land for agricultural purposes?
Well, I believe that the city is growing, so we are going to have to make housing, available. When we do need to expand, and we can't, unless we're going to build upwards, we're going to have to build outwards. I believe that there is still land out there that we can farm. It's just a matter of getting the water to it. So I don't see a problem with expanding the city. I think that there's land out there that, like I said, that is farmable. It just needs to be water to it. So that's a good question for me. I mean, my family's been here since the early 40s, and we've been farming, and basically the city has grown out to where we farm. And so it is starting to turn into development, but we can't be farming inside the city limits either. So that's my stance.
Okay, Mr. Cook?
I have to totally agree. We need to be able to let our city expand. The county is basically the building on the county side. The unincorporated side is built on a family farm. They take a portion of the, maybe the corner of the circle or something, but Rocky says, we need to get water to the dry land side of it. We need to finish up that reclamation project that started years ago and get water up to the North County and some of the dry land.
Thank you. Mr. Beaton.
Would you go ahead and repeat it?
Sure. Agriculture is a huge economic booster to the Franklin County economy, yet we have seen available land for farming being bought and used for urban growth in our cities. Do you have a plan to strike a balance to retain land for agricultural purposes?
So in Franklin County, I mean, we are blessed with a fantastic agricultural base. I mean, with the growing seasons that we have, as well as the rail, the river, every mode of transportation to move our products. I do believe, I mean, agriculture is by far our engine. That being said, in some of my reviews, cropland makes up 56% of our county, and rangeland makes up 32. So that's 88%. I think, you know, we always have to work with the stakeholders, but we one of the blessings we have is a lot of very affordable land, and that's why we are the fastest growing county, or have been off and on for a very long time. So while I do believe we have to strike a balance, I do believe also that we need to, we need to be cognizant when we expand, and I believe we are, but that it's not a problem.
Thank you. Mr. Peck.
If you would, just go ahead and let me have that question one more time.
Okay. Agriculture is a huge economic booster to the Franklin County economy, yet we have seen available land for farming being bought and used for urban growth in our cities. Do you have a plan to strike a balance to retain land for agricultural purposes?
Okay, it was that last part that I wanted to get the precise language on, because there already is a plan. It's state law. It's called the Growth Management Act. It's been in place since the 80s. And for those that aren't familiar, there's an imaginary but very real on maps line around the city of Pasco, for example, that is the urban growth boundary. And that is a boundary by which we need to build within and fill in inside the urban growth boundary before we move outside. So the perception that we're gobbling up farmland and building housing developments in suburbs really isn't correct. The city got this buffer, if you will, of developable land around it, and that's what'll get filled in. And not until that's filled in is the state likely to allow us to move that urban growth boundary farther out. So that is the plan that's in place. I think it's highly effective, it's forward-looking, and certainly not everything about the Growth Management Act is convenient or comfortable. It can be a real pain in the foot sometimes. But I think, by and large, in terms of the balance that you're trying to strike between losing precious farmland and ensuring that we're building within an inner urban area before we go out and take on new farmland, that process is in place, and if somebody comes up with a better solution, then I'm all ears.
Thank you. Okay, and this question will be for all four of you, and we'll begin with you, Mr. Cook. The TRAC has struggled to maintain financial solvency. Do you have a solution to making TRAC a financially viable operation, free of debt and financial bailouts by the county and the city?
That's a difficult question. We talked about this a little earlier today, that venues of that nature historically are not money makers. The best we can do is try to break even, or it's a boon to the city with the taxes they collect off each ticket that is sold. But I think that we have a manager at this point that is taking us in the right direction. He's got some people involved there that is marketing very well. The last couple of quarters have come back in the black. I don't know if we're ahead for the year yet or not, but I think we're going the right direction.
Thank you. Mr. Mullen?
Well, I do agree that the track should be able to break even. That should be its goal. I don't agree with the fact that we want to go forward and concrete the floor. I feel that the track was built for what it is. I don't understand why we need to make it into something that it's not. I think we have to look at the uses for track and see if we can attract more events from out of town. I'm sure there's a lot of people in Seattle that ride horses would like to come over here and host their events in our facility. I also think that we have to look at what events that we can put in place in track that are going to be geared for younger people to get them interested in equine activities. Young people today, they might not have anything to do with their time and end up getting into trouble. And I think that we have to look at the track to say, hey, you know what, this is a facility that our young people can use, get interested in agriculture and equine facilities, and keep them busy. Give them something to work forward to. I think that the value there is sometimes underlooked, but I also think that we need to make sure we have exhausted every other avenue to bring equine events to the track. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Peck.
So the track represents a valuable multifocal type of community meeting place that can serve a lot of needs for the community, and in the process of hosting events there, it generates an awful lot of retail sales tax and hotel tax. And if you factor that into the equation, the economics of track are actually a lot more attractive than they appear on the surface. Having said all that, January through June of last year, the track lost approximately $240,000. Same period this year, January through June, the track profited $7,000. Huge change in 1 year. It's, to my knowledge, the first time track has made money in its history. The change, if you will, the turnaround, I think is largely attributable to the present Board of Commissioners pressing for more accountability in the track and in their operations, and specifically looking at labor costs and requiring the manager, new manager, to do a cost basis analysis on each of the events so that we're breaking them down and we can tell which events make money, which ones don't, which ones perhaps we can charge less for, which ones we need to charge more for. And that's where that turnaround has happened. It is an economic multiplier for our community. We don't ever want it to profit. We want it to break even. If it profits, that means we're charging people too much. It's a great facility. We need to keep it, and I'd be remiss if I didn't thank the city of Pasco, who covers half those costs, be they profits or losses, each year.
Thank you. Mr. Beaton?
I appreciate this question. The track proves that efficient government can change the narrative on an important public assembly property and others like it. At the track, as auditor, I pressed the status quo. On the back of the public works fraud investigation, we became aware of some cash machines. And despite my efforts internally, I had to work through the state auditor, who proved there was resulted in a finding that the cash machines had never been audited, and never been reconciled. And on the back of that, I pressed for, and the board agreed to a performance audit, which we paid $50,000 for. And as that process went on, we changed out management. And that's where this performance has come from, is when you challenge the status quo and you press for improvements, good things can happen. I believe the track needs to empower their advisory board. It has always been underestimated. It has been underutilized, and we lose an opportunity to collaborate in the community and empower people who care just as much as we do about their facility. And so I think that's, again, very important. On this issue, I did write an editorial. It was a two-part editorial that one called for implementation of the performance audit, but the second part that the board has not done, that I would do as your commissioner, is the public discussion about the property and all the land around it. As the city wants to continue to expand with looking at a community facility, I believe we need to have a community discussion on that issue. Thank you.
Thank you. For our last question, I'm going to ask, this is a big question, but I'm going to ask that you limit your answer to 30 seconds. And we'll start with Mr. Beaton. And this is from the audience. What goals do you have for Franklin County?
30 seconds.
Yep. So pick the top one or top two.
Well, the biggest one is for me, is the reason I got the Tri-City Herald endorsement. I believe that the bi-county relationships and the partnerships that are there that are in dismal condition, we've been thrown out of one, we have the director of another suing us. We need to find a way to collaborate and work together with our bi-county partners to offer more efficient government to the Franklin County. Excuse me, to the Franklin County citizens.
Thank you. Mr. Peck?
Fiscal sustainability for counties, private property rights, consolidating 911 service, first and foremost, getting the mental health problem fixed once and for all, And I want to point out that on the bi-county relationships, I support bi-county programs 1,000%. But I tell you that the people of Franklin County elected me, nobody else. And so I will always put the interests of the people of Franklin County first in our bi-county arrangements. They recently said we owed them $665,000. I was the only one that would put my hand up and challenge it. And in the end, we didn't owe them a penny. So I saved you $665,000 right there. I will work with them, but I will always defend your interests first.
Mr. Cook.
Thank you. Yes. Pardon?
Goals, but I know it's a lot to cover.
Yeah, where do you start? You know, fiscal sustainability is probably our first one. We're going through, you know, some issues right now with some legalities that were found against us, and I think that's going to be our biggest hurdle for the next couple of years.
Thank you. Mr. Mullen?
I think we need to have open meetings with the county electeds to discuss county direction and planning. Where are we going? How are we going to get there? The county needs to set goals and then follow up on the progress. People don't plan to fail, they fail to plan. I would work with the electeds to work hard to strengthen the bi-county relationship. This is definitely, we need it, they need it. The same problems that happen here are happening over there. They don't stop at the river, so we need to work together to find a solution that works for both of us. Franklin County needs direction and leadership, and thank you very much.
Okay, so you'll get to continue for one more minute on your goals, if you choose to, in your closing statements. And we're going to go reverse from what we started. So, Mr. Mullen, you can continue with goals if you like for a minute in your closing statement.
Okay. My closing statement is I love Franklin County, and I'm proud to call this home. I've lived here my entire life. We have farms here and ranches up north. The things that I would like to see changed, again, are more openness, more transparency. We need to work together. We need to empower the people that we have working in the courthouse now. I think we should have more meetings to find out how we can run more efficiently. I'm sure that there's a lot of good people working in there that have a lot of good ideas, and I don't think they're being shared. I think we need to have a public meeting and discuss different avenues to run more efficiently. I bring a new perspective, energy, and a desire to succeed. I thank you for your time and consideration. I hope to work at Franklin County Commissioner and to make it successful, and I'd appreciate your vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Cook.
Yes, to wrap things up, I appreciate the time here that everybody's taken, and the audience that and some of the questions that have come up. They're good, to the point, tough questions, and I'm looking forward to, you know, I enjoy what I do. I enjoy the commission. I feel I have a lot of history stemming back from early years, and as I said earlier, I feel that we definitely need a North County representative. When I first got here, I don't think anybody knew there was Franklin County any further north than Sagemore. So worked hard to change that issue.
Thank you. Mr. Peck.
So I think it was my absolute privilege to serve you as an Air Force officer for more than two decades. I think the experience that gave me, the extensive leadership and management training, critical thinking, serving at the highest levels with the Joint Chiefs of Staff and the Pentagon, the level of trust and integrity and precision required to do that kind of work is what I offer in Franklin County. I think that's probably in part why I've been endorsed by the local Farm Bureau, the Washington State Farm Bureau, the Tri-City Association of Realtors, the Tri-City Home Builders Association, nearly every state representative in the districts that overlap our county. retired Congressman Doc Hastings, and the list goes on. These are people of great accomplishment, insight, intelligence. They've put their confidence in me. I would ask the people of Franklin County to continue to do that. And lastly, I want to emphasize that probably like everybody else up here, there are many things that we could do with our time, many careers. For me, this is about three things: service, service, and service. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mr. Beaton.
I have the endorsement of the Tri-City Herald, particularly because they know, as I believe, the importance of the bi-county relationships. I also have the support of the two state-level leaders that I've worked with in my function as your auditor, Secretary of State Kim Wyman and retired State Auditor Brian Sontag have written statements regarding working with me and my leadership style. As your auditor for the past 6 years, I've worked with every department to drive change and progress that Franklin County needs. I've worked to live up to my campaign commitments of integrity and transparency. And as the years have gone on, I've tried to live by the leadership principles that include establishing a clear mission and vision with the team, communicating those expectations, but more importantly, valuing the people I work with, helping them build their career and have meaningful work in their lives. Franklin County needs new leadership, and I'm committed to deliver it. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to thank these candidates for being with us tonight, and stay seated after we clap because I have a few closing remarks. So this concludes tonight's forum. I want to remind you, if you're not yet registered to vote, which I'm guessing you all are since you're here, but you can still do so online or by mail. We have forms in the back of the room by October 8th. If you have never registered to vote before, you may go to the county auditor's office and do so up until October 31st. I want to thank you all for attending, and a special thanks to the City of Pasco, in particular the Pasco Police Department, for allowing us to use this facility. We will be back here again next week on Wednesday evening, October 12th, when we will be hosting a forum to hear from the candidates running for Attorney General for the State of Washington and the Office of Superintendent of Public Instruction for the State of Washington. And then we will also, the next night, Thursday, October 13th, be hosting a forum at CBC in the Jurdy Auditorium for the Secretary of State candidates. So hopefully you'll all be able to attend those.